It was a monumental clash of cultures. In one corner, there was Rodgers and Hammerstein, the most American and the most heartfelt of Broadway songwriters. In the other, you had Gertrude Laurence, a British spitfire, the most sophisticated and glamorous of musical stage performers. Despite the gulf between them, Rodgers and Hammerstein would collaborate with Laurence on a show that would be remembered as a career landmark for all three. A musical clash of cultures that still resonates today, The King and I. As the 1950s began, Laurence was interested in appearing in a big old Broadway smash. She brought a novel to the team entitled Anna and the King of Siam, based on the real-life chronicles of a Welsh schoolmistress named Anna Leonowens, as she taught the children of the Siamese king Mangkhut at the height of the Victorian era.
Getting to know you, getting to know all about you.
Having acquired a star as their eye, the team approached Hollywood and theater royalty for their king, Rex Harrison, Noel Coward, and Alfred Drake. They all turned down the role. In near despair, Rodgers and Hammerstein auditioned a television director born in Vladivostok, Yul Brynner. He had a guitar, said Rodgers, and he hit his guitar one whack and gave out with this unearthly yell and sang some heathenish sort of thing. Oscar and I looked at each other and said, well, that's it.
Oh, oh, sometimes I think that people going mad. Sometimes I think that people not so bad.
The Siamese setting was the most exotic that Rodgers and Hammerstein had ever encountered. But they took up the challenge with an inventive score and a book that built its texture out of centuries of Siamese court rituals. They were aided immeasurably by the dramatic choreography of the young Jerome Robbins, the first and only time he would work with Rodgers and Hammerstein. Typically, the romance in a musical would be between its leading characters. But the real passion in The King and I is for tolerance and progress. Still, amidst all their cultural sparring, the show simmers with an unspoken romantic tension between Anna and the King. This unique perspective, the exotic setting, the stunning design, and the chemistry between its leads catapulted The King and I immediately into hit status. Opening on March 29, 1951, it ran for more than 3 years and won 5 Tony Awards, including Best Musical. Gertrude Laurence won for Best Actress in a Musical, while Brynner won for Best Featured Actor. His name was below the title. Brynner would ascend the billing throne when The King and I was made into a CinemaScope blockbuster in 1956. With most of the material intact, Brynner reprised his role, now opposite Deborah Carr, and won an Oscar for his performance as Best Actor. The King had reclaimed his crown. Over the next 3 decades, Brynner would take on the mantle of the King for over 4,600 performances in various revivals, becoming nearly synonymous with the role. Still, the show has whistled its own happy tune through numerous other productions around the world and on Broadway. A revival in 1996 featured an all-Asian cast playing the Siamese court for the first time. The most recent revival at Lincoln Center Theater in 2015 also cast the court with all Asian American actors and treated the show's Siamese context with dignity and respect. Kelly O'Hara, one of the most acclaimed Broadway actresses of her generation, won her first Tony Award as Mrs. Anna. From west to east, The King and I still retains its power to captivate audiences, get them to reflect on their own values, and move them to tears as well.
Etc., etc., etc.
Very well, Your Majesty.